Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Great El Bethel family and friends. It is another Wednesday night that the Lord has brought us to, another opportunity to hear and receive an inspirational message, something to help rejuvenate our souls and our minds and refocus us and remind us that God is still in control. Another day that we get to hear what thus says the Lord, and I'm excited about it. I don't know about you, but I hope so far that your week has been going pretty well and you have truly felt the presence of God on this week so far. again, thank you all for tuning in on tonight. And again, we hope something is said that you could take it and apply it to your everyday living, that you may have a true closer walk with Him. Just before we get started, let's have a word of prayer and then we will go higher from there. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, how we thank you for this another day's journey. God, we thank you for this another opportunity to be able to hear a word from you. Now, God, we pray that you would forgive us for all of our unforgiven sins. God, we pray that you would create within us a clean heart, renew within us the right spirit, oh God, that we could truly feel your presence, consecrate our hearts and our minds, that we may be receptive to your word. But then, God, right now, I pray a special blessing over everyone that's watching, every household that's represented, oh God. Father, I pray for those that are going to tune in. Father, I just pray that you move like only you can. Now, God, be with us, strengthen us, Father, sit me down that you may be able to stand, oh God, that they can see you and less of me. Have thine own way like only you can, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, we are at another wonderful Bible study. Again, I hope your week has been going well. And like I do on Sundays, I'm going to do it right now. I'm going to ask that anyone that can and will, if you're not too mean, to be a part of our outreach and evangelism ministry, amen. I want you to hit the share, the like, the start a watch party, or whatever the case may be, just so that we could get the word out and be able to truly share and be able to spread the gospel like God would have us to do. So hit the share button, hit the like button, hit the start a watch party, all of that stuff, so we could get the message out. Or even send a text and say, hey, we having Bible study, and let them know to jump on as well. But tonight we definitely will try not to be on here too long, but we will not quench the spirit as well. This week, we've seen some things and we've experienced some things that kind of reminds us and keep us in the right mind frame and the right track of the theme that Pastor McNeely has shared with us, in that of compassion and love. So tonight is the last Wednesday of this month, I believe, and we're going to close out with that same theme. We're going to dive in a little bit on some scripture and see how we can truly apply it to our lives and be able to truly display that of compassion that the Lord would have us to do. In the book of Acts, the second chapter, verses 41 through 46, I'm going to read it from the NIV version, Acts, the second chapter, verses 41 through 46, and it reads as follows. Those who accept his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Scroll down to this next part that says, y'all, hold on, it changed on me. There it is. All believers were together and they had everything in common. That right there. All the believers were together and they had everything in common. They sold their property, possession, give to anyone with need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with a glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to the number, the daily, those who were being saved. Here in this particular few verses, one thing that I really want to point out is how here they are. Paul explains how they were on basically one accord. They were they had the same mindset. They were all moving and walking in the same direction. They were all had the same mind to be helpful, to show love, to show compassion, to give the best that they could to help somebody else out. It was totally different. Totally different from the scenarios that we are seeing playing out today in today's time. It's totally different of how it used to be when you actually genuinely cared for somebody and their well-being and how they were doing and how they felt, their mental state of being. It was totally different because they was all on one accord, had the same mindset, and still they were all trying to do their very best to be as Christ-like as possible. And the more they did, the more they tried, the more they showed an effort, the more they blessed one another, and they had this caring and this kind heart, the more people came, the fold, the numbers, it said, grew rapidly. And things like that happen when you seem to be showing somebody some type of love and compassion. You know, those things rub off on people. Your attitude and how you carry yourself and what you do and what other people see you do. Do you not know that those things rub off to the next person and you become contagious and people start to do the things and give you the same energy that you're giving them? And that's the hard mindset and the hard place to be in is right now we are so divided. We are so at odds that it's starting to grow and multiply. Just like anything else that's negative. Just like any other negativity. Whenever anything that's negative happens to show up, whenever anything that's negative that happens to be there, people flock to negativity. I don't know what it is about it, but people flock to negativity because, first of all, they're nosy. They want to see what's going on. But what happens when we all get on one accord and have the same mindset? What happens when we all are moving in the same direction? Imagine the contagious atmosphere that would be if everybody showed a sense of love and compassion. If I could use the phrase from years ago that made headlines and went all across and became what we would say viral nowadays, is can we all just get along? I may have dodged a bullet. I'm not sure, but yesterday I think I may have dodged a bullet because my son had a basketball game and we went to the basketball game because we're gonna support and be there for him. But in the process of that, I had intentions. I wanted to watch it. I missed the debate. But for some reason, you know, through social media and everything else, it seems like I didn't miss much. It seems like I missed a crying and shouting match. It seems like I missed some stuff that wasn't very professional. Seems like I missed some things. And the unfortunate state of being in the state of mind that I received just by me missing and what I'm hearing is we need real love and compassion like we've never needed it before. When we have such a divisiveness in society, when we have such a divisiveness in just walking down the street, just going outside, just going to the store, you don't know which way to really go that is of comfort, that is of safety. You're constantly having to watch over your shoulder because you don't know who's all of a sudden got this bold sense of mentality of saying that they can do any and everything. We live in an unfortunate society that it's very necessary that love and compassion comes in. I can only imagine if we thought about it and we use what Paul was talking about here on how they were all on one accord. They all had common goals. Let's talk about that for a second. Common goals. And when I say common goals, I don't mean common goals like, hey, we want to make the same amount of money. No, I don't mean common goals like, oh, we want to get the same class level of car. I don't mean we want to have, you know, we starting the businesses and doing that and the other. I don't mean those common goals. I mean the common goals of saying, I want to be more like Christ. I want to walk like him. I want to do my best, even though I can't get all the way there because I'm a wretch undone. I want to do my very best in having a common goal of being just like him. And I can only imagine that he's talking about it. Everybody still had the common goal. They had God's glory in mind. They had the mindset of knowing that God is going to receive the glory in everything I do. They had this mindset of knowing that, hey, even in my very own church, they had, Lord have mercy, they had the same mission, the same goal, the same mindset of helping and bringing in those that were lost into the fold, into the flock, because it said the numbers grew daily, which means they were testifying, they were evangelizing, they were outreaching, they were going and doing their very best to help and bring someone in. They all had the same mission. They all had the same goal. They all had the same one accord mindset to say, I want to be like him. I want to be like him. Common goal of God's glory, common goal of church mission. Matter of fact, they all had the same common values. People nowadays, it seems as though there is no commonality in values or morals. It seems like people put value in the wrong things and people's morals are in the wrong places, and it turns into a total selfish world. It's turning into, I can't do nothing for anybody else. It's a dog-eat-dog world. It's me, myself, and I have to focus on me because right now I need to do everything possible to make sure that I'm doing. It's like we forgot about what God would have us to do. We've forgotten that it's more than going to church on Sunday, going to Bible study or whatever the case may be, viewing it online. It's more than just receiving the word and holding it for yourself. We receive the word of God. When you study, when you go through, when you're looking at scripture, when you're looking and you're studying the word of God and he's giving you different things, he's giving you information, he's pouring into your heart, he's telling you different things of how we should be walking and talking and helping and loving and this, that, and the other. He didn't leave those things for us to hold on and embed it and just keep it and hoard it ourselves. Yes, he gives it to us for us to build ourselves up. However, it is also given to us that we may go out and do. I believe it says, be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. So therefore, if you are just hearing, it's difficult to get the word out that God is love. It's difficult to get the word out that we ought to love one another. It's difficult to get the word out that we should be on one accord and having the same mindset. And when you take it and you look and then you sit back and we wonder, what is this world coming to? What is going on in this world? What is happening in this world that we can't see change? We don't see it. We're doing our very best to make sure that we try to pull it out and we try to move forward. We try to make things better. But the more, and it's just what it is. The more we try, the more we push, the more we strive to do what's better and try to do what God would have us to do and bring people in and have the same common faith in God, the same common mindset of helping, the more we try to do that, the more the devil is going to get busy. He is going to fight. He is going to scratch. He's going to do everything possible because he doesn't want that. He doesn't want that. As a matter of fact, sometimes we can start in our very own home. Sometimes we can start at our very own job. Sometimes we can start at our very own churches. Being on one accord. Moving in the same direction. Moving in a way of betterment to help somebody along the way. Paul is giving some stuff. He's talking. He's saying, man, he's saying, look at what happened. Look at what took place. Look at the glory of God that happened to be manifest in just by being on one accord. Multiplication happened. I don't know about you, but when you're doing things out of the goodness of your heart, when you're doing things, notice, out of the goodness of your heart and not expecting anything in return, that's truly out of the goodness of your heart of saying, I saw a need, I addressed the need, I fixed the need to the best of my ability, and I let God handle the rest. Listen, when you do those things, God is going to grant an increase in your heart, in your mind that you won't believe. There are some things that some folks have been praying for right now. And as a matter of fact, you've been praying for success. You've been praying for a breakthrough. You've been praying for something to happen, for a big purchase or whatever the case may be. You've been gathering up everything that you possibly can, holding on to it, because possibly it's something that you need to get you to where you're going. But listen, let me share something with you. If you are trying to move forward and you're trying to get somewhere and you think, oh, I got to hold on to everything that I have so I can make it where I'm trying to get to. Listen, that unfortunately is not how God operates. I've come to discover that's not how he operates. Yeah, he blesses me. He gives me some things, but I've realized and I've understood that everything that he gives me is not necessarily for me. And if it's not necessarily for me, it's for me to bless somebody else. And when I take what's not for me and bless who I'm supposed to be giving it to, guess what? I won't turn and all of a sudden, not expecting it, not looking for it because I'm doing it out of goodness of my heart, I'll turn around and realize, oh, now I got way too much more. I got so much more that I needed because I was trying to do what God would have me to do. I was trying to truly walk and talk like God. I was true. Listen, if my hand is closed, some of you heard the analogy, and I believe it's a real true analogy. If your hand is closed, guess what? Nothing can get in and nothing can get out either. But if your hand is open, stuff can get in, stuff can go out, more can come in. It's just how it is. As a matter of fact, we got to stop and think about it. If If God wants me to love somebody, if God wants me to love everybody, now I understand, trust me, it is a hard, cold world that we live in. It is very difficult to love everybody. Now, let me clear that up. I ain't saying that that you got to go out and find the meanest person in the world, the most racist person in the world, or whatever the case. I ain't saying go out and just, I gotta hug you and love you. No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is we should still love the person. We don't have to love the act. We shouldn't love the act, but we should still love the person enough to have the ability to still lift them up to God, because obviously it's going to take him to fix it. And that's where compassion comes in. Compassion comes in and says, listen, we may not see eye to eye. We may not be on the same page, but I have enough love and compassion to know that I still love you, but I don't love what you're doing. It is what it is. But we have to have a true mentality of saying, I want to be more like him. I want to walk with him. I want to talk with him. I want to tell him. I just want to have a communication with God and tell him to lead me where he wants me to go. And when we do those things, listen, he'll break through. As a matter of fact, what are some of the things? What are some of the things that can hold us back? What are some of the things that are keeping us from truly being united? What are some of the things that are keeping, and I don't even want you to go as far as to what's going on in the world. I don't even want you to go as far as that. There are some close-knit things right around us that we could fix first, and it can spread abroad, just like it did, and Paul was talking about. It started to go out, and people started to come in. But what are the close-knit things? What are the things that are right now that are holding people back from unity? I'll tell you one right off the bat. The first one that jumps out to me is pride. Pride gets in the way all the time. No, Reverend, I can't do that. No, Reverend, I ain't going to be able to do that. That's just not me. That's just not my character. I'm not going to be able to. No, they did me so bad. They did me so wrong. They did this, that, and the other. I get it. But that's simply your pride being in the way. And let me tell you, pride will get in the way and block you and get in the way of your blessing. Pride to be in the way. And then another thing is selfishness. Me, myself, and I. That's my concern. That's what I'm worried about. That's what I'm focusing on. Me, myself, and I. What else will get in the way? The last is just a lack of love. Just so full of hate. Just so full of Just full of always wanting to cause commotion and drama and this, that, and the other. A lack of love. These are things that get in the way. These are things that block us. These are things that hinder us from moving forward. So I really want to challenge you. I want to challenge you with the mindset and just trying to figure out what's truly stopping me from having a genuine love and developing a common ground with some other people around me, that we could get together and we could push forward and we could move and we could make things happen. What's really blocking me? I challenge you to figure out what that is. And when you figure out what that is, I challenge you to turn it over to God. I know some people got some stuff that's been going on for years. Some people got some stuff that is just a second nature to them. But look at those things and say, listen, God, I need you to help me. I need you to remove it because it's stopping me from moving forward. It's stopping me from doing what you would have me to do. I challenge you to look at those things that's in your way, that's blocking your blessings, that's causing you to sit back and be stagnated in your situation. You want to be a stream. You want to be a stream with water constantly flowing and moving, fresh water moving through. You're constantly getting blessings. You're constantly allowing those blessings to go too. As a matter of fact, you ever noticed that a pond is just so stagnated? A pond is stagnated. Water constantly is going into the pond, but the levels don't change. It stays the same. But water's constantly going in. Why? It's because of selfishness. It's because of a pride. It's because of there's no outlet of saying, hey, it's almost like I'm hoarding everything that I have, but I ain't getting any better. You have to be able to share. You have to be able to say, hey, listen, I want to pray for you, and you pray for me, and we're going to grow together. And after I pray for you and you pray for me, let's go find somebody else. And we're going to invite them in, and we're going to pray, and we're going to move forward. We're going to pray for power. We're going to pray for peace. We're going to pray for prosperity. We're going to pray that we can get on one accord. We're going to pray that our society gets better. And then just keep that going. Keep that going. And once you, next thing you know, you'll find out you'll have a great large prayer circle. You'll find out that, oh, I got a bunch of folk around me who have a sense of same common ground of trusting and knowing what God can do. That's how it happens. That's how it starts. By everybody being on one accord, by everybody walking in the same direction, by everybody, regardless of what the devil may be telling you, being able to combat that with the power and the sense of God to know, devil, you lying. You're not telling the truth. I realize and know that God is going to do it because he said he's going to do it. The devil's going to tell you, no, it's not going to happen. The devil's going to tell you, oh, you just ought to sit down. And the devil's going to tell you, oh, just hold on to everything you got. The devil's going to tell you that you're not going to get blessed if you do this. However, stop listening to him. Stop listening to him. Well, how do I know who the devil is? How do I know what's being said? How do I have the discernment to know? Listen, there's something about the sweet, savory voice of God when he speaks to you. Something about it, because it when he speaks to you, he gives you a sense of urgency, a sense of inner, just something on the inside that's full of fire, that's full of just, and you can't stop from doing it. That's how you know, listen, God wanted me to do this. God put this in my heart. God put this in my mind that I should be helping somebody. We have to have the love. We have to have the compassion. And when we have those things, watch the change that's going to come. Watch the blessing that's going to happen. And in those moments, stop. And first of all, rejoice that you just witnessed and saw God move. But then say thank you. And then just ask the Lord, Lord, keep it going. Keep it coming. Keep it coming. Listen, we cheer, and we when something happens that's good, we quick to say, oh, let it keep going. Let it keep happening. Some of y'all go to casinos, and when y'all on the road and y'all get it, oh, keep it going because it's happening. We ought to have the same mentality with God. Listen, God, listen, you blessing me. Keep it going. Come on, God, let it keep coming. But also realize that the more we work, the more we do what God would have us to do, the more we allow our actions to show that we have faith in him and we trust and we believe what he said, the more he's going to do. If it's in his will. If it's designed by him. But if it's designed by him, it's going to happen. And when it happens, share it. Bring somebody else. That's what happens when we're all on one accord. That's what happens when God is moving. That's what happens. Listen, there are some things that are going to happen that when you see it, you're going to say, nobody did that but God. As a matter of fact, some of us got some testimonies already to where we can say, nobody did that but God. But he's got some new things, Lord have mercy. He's got some new things that he's going to do. So you might as well get ready, put your shouting shoes on and get ready. And my goodness, get ready to thank him and praise him when he does it. All right, that's what I have for tonight. For us to walk on a common ground, on one accord, with the same love and compassion for one another that God has for us, that he has for us. And watch what happens. Watch how everything turns out and it grows. I challenge you, remember, I challenge you, find what's blocking you from truly showing that love and compassion. Do your best to remove it. Ask God to fix it so that you can truly display the love and compassion that God would have you to do. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, how we thank you just for, first of all, showing us how to love, how to be compassionate, how to care for one another. God, we thank you for the roadmap and the example that you've set. Time and time again, we thank you just for allowing us just this another chance to be reminded that we ought to love one another just as you loved us. Now, God, I pray right now for everyone that's watching, oh God, that you would pour out your love and your compassion and your strength within us. That, oh God, that we could truly feel it, but not only that we feel it, that we may display it and act upon it, that someone can see it through us and realize and know that you are the main source of love. Now, God, I pray again for every household, everybody that's watching, oh God. Father, whatever the desire is, Father, if it be your will, Father, I pray that you would allow it to be done. If it's healing, if it's a breakthrough, Father, whatever the case may be, I'm thankful that I have enough faith to know that you're going to do it. Now, God, have thine own way. Like only you can. God, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for everyone that's tuned in. We thank you that you are still sitting high, looking low, blessing us in spite of. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Listen, I am just a couple of quick announcements, but let me first say thank you all so much for your continued faithfulness, for those that continually tune in. Week after week, on Sundays, on Wednesdays. Listen, let me express a major sense of gratitude and thanks on behalf of Greater El Bethel Church family and Pastor McNeely. We thank you all so much. We don't take it lightly because you could be anywhere, tuned into anywhere, and we thank you all so much for that faithfulness. Let me say that we are asking prayer for Brother Keegan Smith. Sister Smith asked for prayer. I see you on there, Sister Smith. I know we're praying for Brother Keegan that God put healing in his body, that he could get well soon, and that household. And we're praying for him. But also, we're praying for each and every one of you. Also, Sister Williams, I saw that you put something earlier about being ill. So we're praying for you as well. Ali Eunice, we're praying for you as well. Also, let me say this. Please be in prayer for Pastor McNeely. On yesterday, Pastor McNeely was in a car accident. He is doing well. He's in the hospital for observations, and he will be back home, I believe, I was told, probably tomorrow. So he's pretty sore, but he is well. So please, please be in prayer for him, that God would continue to touch his body. But he was in a car accident on yesterday, but he will probably be home on tomorrow. So God, we thank God for that. So continue to keep him lifted up in your thoughts and your prayers. And last but not least, Sunday is rapidly approaching. Amen. I know that you've been watching. We've been posting it. Sunday, we will be reopening for service. Amen. But we rejoice in that, but we will have to do it very strategically, and it is required, must register to attend. The link to register is open on our website at www.gebdallas.com. The link is there. There are limited seats. There will be a list that we will be checking at the door to make sure that you've registered accordingly. Let's make sure that we do this as decent and in order as we possibly can. Again, like we've said before, we want to ensure everyone's safety, and we want to make sure that we're keeping an accurate count as well as names of those who attend each of our services. So please, ma'ams and sirs, be obedient. Don't just try to just show up. We want you to be obedient and truly and register at the website. Once we reach capacity, the registration link will close. So once we reach capacity of what we're accepting to come in for that service, it will close. We will open registration each Tuesday. Every Tuesday prior to the Sunday, leading up to that Sunday, it will open. So make sure that you're doing, being obedient and actually registering. If you felt sick or you've been sick, you've been exposed, please, ma'ams and sirs, stay at home. Do not register. Let someone else be able to have that spot. But read the guidelines. Our reopening plan is posted everywhere. You can see it anywhere. Make sure that you read and you follow those guidelines. But however, we rejoice that we gonna be able to get a few folk in there. We've been preaching the pews for quite some time, and we can't wait to have somebody in front of us. So we rejoice and we're excited that we've gotten to this point. Keep in mind, we're still monitoring and making sure, but we are excited about Sunday. So make sure that you register, get in there, and come on and have a mighty good time in the Lord. Amen. I don't think I have anything else. I think that is about all that I have on tonight. Again, thank you all so much. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for your faithfulness. And we love each and every one of you so much. Truth is here always.
Lord.